newspapers of his own. He started a newspaper called Karate or Betwana in 1902. There were a few that then followed on after that. But when those folded, he really spent a good part of his time in his life trying to revitalize the newspapers, trying to get them going again. So Plaatje, I think the first thing in my book is that he was a pioneer in the history of the black press in South Africa. The second thing, of course, thinking back to my earlier comments about native life in South Africa, Plaatje was a political spokesman, an advocate of the first order. He was a man of actions as well as words. He was involved, as many of you will know, as the first General Secretary of the African National Congress, or South African Native National Congress, as it was called then. He was the leading figure in the campaign against the Natives Land Act of 1930. He took the campaign to England, to London, to protest to the British imperial government, and he stayed on in London when the other delegates returned home. He was determined to make that case. And I think this was an instance of where Plaatje, as an individual, decided to go his own way. In fact, on this occasion, going against the advice and the requests of the ANC to return home. Plaatje maybe is remembered for his political campaign against the Land Act, but of course there were many other political matters that he was involved in. Later in life, he actually said that he was even more upset about a piece of legislation called the Native Administration Act of 1927, which is not nearly so well known today. But the effect of that legislation was to set up separate areas in different parts of the country for black and white, and it was to separate the administration of justice. And the key effect of that, as Plaatje saw it, was to deny Africans access to a common judicial system. And he actually felt even more strongly about this than the Land Act of 1913. So I think what Plaatje did was he bore witness. He gave a voice to the voiceless. He represented people. And he particularly represented people in the rural areas whose interests he felt were sadly neglected during his lifetime. And he was never one to give up. He simply kept going. And I think beneath all of this was a vision that Plaatje had of a common society. And he looked back in some ways in a rather old-fashioned kind of way to a kind of Victorian era, which didn't have the place for the kind of racialized system that later predominated in South Africa. So the third point I would wish to make about Plaatje's importance is that he was a very great writer. And a writer, for one thing, in English. English, actually, was not his first language, it wasn't his second language, it was his third language, which I think makes the nature of his achievement all the more remarkable. And I think he was a wonderful stylist in my book. This is evidenced in three perhaps of his best known books. I'm thinking particularly of his Mafeking diary, I'm thinking of Native Life in South Africa, and I'm thinking of his novel, Mhudi. And I think in those three books, you have encapsulated the personal in the diary, you have the political very powerfully in Native Life in South Africa, and you have Mhudi, which I guess you could call a novel of decolonization almost. It was a pioneering attempt to present an African view of African life and African history. And I think a book that preceded, foreshadowed in a way, books like Chinua Achebe's Things Fall Apart. And I think Plaatje increasingly is recognized as a pioneer in that. I think those three books, when I first got interested in Plaatje all of those years ago, it left me puzzled. I mean, how could one man have written three such different books? I suppose since then, I've really tried to kind of answer that puzzle. You know, what about, you know, how was it that somebody could write in such different registers, but in such a convincing manner in each case. Now that was English. I should come next to Setswana. Mikey, of course, was a great proponent, a great defender of Setswana. He was desperately concerned about the language's survival. And for Mikey, Setswana was not just a means of communication, but it was what actually held society together. And he saw it as a repository of traditions, and indeed of the identity of his people as a whole. And there were endless battles that Mikey was involved in right from the beginning. To begin with, it was with missionaries who tended to mispronounce the language, to come up with orthographies that did not properly represent the sounds of the language as he saw it. And it then developed into a series of wider battles, not just with missionaries, but with government officials, once this became a matter of concern in government circles. And of course, Plaatje wrote in Setswana. He collected proverbs. He put together a Setswana reader, he called it. He worked with a colleague of his, T.M. Ramoswana, on a dictionary. It was a hugely ambitious project, of which virtually nothing has survived. And of course, he's well known, I think, for having a fascination with Shakespeare, and he translated a number of Shakespeare's plays into Setswana. Indeed, he was the first African from any part of the continent to translate Shakespeare into any African language. Again, sadly, much of what he wrote was lost, but two of his books did survive, and I've certainly benefited in the way that I've tried to write about this, from the work of people like Professor Schoeller, who I'm glad to say, honoured that he is with us today. Many years ago, he wrote a wonderful article about Plaatje and his translation of Tshekisho. And indeed, I think he was one of the first people really to have taken Plaatje's engagement with Shakespeare seriously. I think it had been either rather dismissed as a kind of succumbing to a form of cultural imperialism. What business had any African to be interested in Shakespeare? Well, Plaatje had very good reason to be interested in Shakespeare. And I think what has become clear, not least from Professor Schoeller's work, is the way that Plaatje used Shakespeare in the interests of Setswana, rather than seeing things the other way around. So I think if you put all of that together, it's not difficult to see why Plaatje has become, if you like, a hugely important symbol of achievement, black achievement, but I think achievement, South African achievement, more generally. Now, all of those things I've just outlined, I think most people would agree that these are what constitute Plaatje's most notable, if you like, public achievements. But of course, our judgments are covered by subsequent developments, by later history, and indeed by the wisdom of hindsight. I rather formed the view that the task of a biographer is to try to go beyond this, and to understand people in the context of their own times, and to pay attention to what was important to them. What influenced them, rather than just by what later generations prefer to remember. So in the book that I've just completed, I've tried to look at a number of other things apart from these kind of well-known achievements. Certainly I've done my best to elucidate and to clarify a number of aspects on that. But I've also looked, for example, at things like the IOTT, the Independent Order of True Templars, which probably not many people will have heard of. It was a temperance organization, which may not be the most popular cause, but for Plaatje, it was immensely important. And he really devoted, particularly in the 1920s, a good part of his life to promoting its cause. Similarly, he was involved in another organization, organization called the Brotherhood Movement, which was an inter-denominational religious movement that believed in brotherhood between people and brotherhood between nations. And Plaatje thought it was an immense force for good. And he got a lot of support from this organization when he was in England during the First World War, and then took it back to South Africa to set up his own branch of it. Now, it didn't last much longer after his death, and today is all but forgotten, and in England as well. So I imagine I give these as examples of things that were of concern to Plaatje, but may not have kind of hit the headlines, as it were, in terms of the way that it's remembered today. And so one of the things that I've tried to do is to, I think, restore Plaatje's interest and concern with these somewhat unfashionable causes to an understanding of his life as a whole. I've also looked, I think, actually quite fascinated by looking at issues where Plaatje took a difference and often quite unpopular view. For example, Plaatje was in favour of the Union of South Africa in 1910, when the colonies came together, at a time when the other African political organisations, predecessors to the ANC, did not take this view. They took the view that the British imperial government should not be relinquishing control with such a racist constitution. But Plaatje was in favour of the Union of South Africa because he thought that it would extend to the protectorates, and he was thinking particularly of Bechuanaland, which was of particular concern to it. It would extend to them the protection of the Supreme Court of South Africa. And that was a reflection of his deep commitment, his deep immersement in the legal traditions of the Cape Colony. Similarly, there were another set of issues arose at the time of the South African War, arose in relation to the treatment of Boer prisoners. And Plaatje actually found himself on several occasions pleading for the life of Boer prisoners who were convicted of murdering his compatriots. But he felt that in other cases, in other circumstances, people had been left off, that it was therefore right and proper, and following legal precedent, that the same should happen. So that was a reflection, I think, of the way that Plaatje would often form views that were not widely accepted by other people. He was very much his own man, and on views like that, he went his own way. I've also tried to present as rounded and as full a picture as I can of Plaatje's family life, particularly his relations with his wife, Elizabeth. It's difficult because although quite a lot of Plaatje's letters, correspondence has survived, not a single letter has survived between Plaatje and his wife, Elizabeth, despite the fact that given that he was away from home so often and used to write home once a week, an awful lot of letters were written, but tragically, they've all simply disappeared. But Plaatje did say on one occasion, if I may just give you a rather interesting quote from him, he wrote, "Few men can boast of a spouse so faithful under such trying circumstances. She's been remarkably patient bringing up the children almost alone during the past years." And that pretty much was the situation. And I'm trying to, I suppose, get to grips with the reality and the implications of that, including looking at Plaatje's children. He had, in the end, quite a difficult relationship with his eldest son, Sol Plaatje. And I think that does need to be seen in terms of the amount of time that he simply spent away. I've tried also in this book to spend, I hope not a disproportionate amount of time in looking at Plaatje's early years, because it seems to me that an understanding of where he came from was essential to understanding where he ended up. So I've looked at for example, the depth of his roots in a Baroque society, which had a lifelong influence. It colored his whole being for the entirety of his life. I've looked in a bit of detail at his mission upbringing, and indeed was fortunate to have found a lot of new, very interesting material in German mission archives, in Berlin mostly, because he was brought up on a German-run mission society, and they were meticulous in writing down everything that went on their mission station. So I think there's some very interesting new material that gives a far fuller picture of Plaatje's early life than has existed before. I'm in similar vein, I think, you know, when he went on after getting a job as a postman in Kimberley, he was subject to what became part of a kind of vibrant social life that characterised African life in Kimberley at that time. And I think this is something that again has been rather lost from the literature. For many young men like Plaatje, Kimberley was a place of opportunity. He and his colleagues had every hope for the future. They had the vote. In theory, they were treated equally in the law. And I think they felt that there was every prospect that their position might improve rather than deteriorate. So I think that was one of is one of the main things I've tried to do in this book, is to root Plaatje's subsequent career far more firmly in his early years. But what I wanted to do to just give you a little bit of a flavour, so far as time permits, is just to read one or two passages to give you a sense, I suppose, of the way that I've gone about trying to write about Plaatje's life. The first one I would like to share from you, is from 1899, which is the outbreak of the South African War. This was a time where Plaatje found himself working as an interpreter in Mafeking. And after a couple of weeks, he was, I think, very pleased to find himself still alive. And he decided to sit down and write a diary, which, as we know, was subsequently published. And I was intrigued to know, well, why did he decide to write a diary? So these were my thoughts. Quite why he began a diary, he did not say. Plenty of others around him had the same idea. Charles Bell, magistrate, better informed than most, had begun his on the 1st of October, and at some point asked Plaatje to type it out for him. William Geyer, the first clerk and assistant magistrate, had embarked upon his in a rather more desultory way on the 10th of October, and so too had plenty of others in Mafeking, soldiers and civilians alike. With time on their hands and a sense that momentous events were about to unfold, writing about their experiences and describing what they saw was just the natural thing to do. But even without their example, Plaatje had little need of encouragement. He would have been very familiar, after all, with the genre. Published diaries such as those of Samuel Pepys, John Evelyn, Queen Victoria were read widely in the English-speaking world, and diary writing was a popular pastime. O'Neill, staying with the West Baths, these were the missionaries, he had first-hand experience of the missionaries' dedication to recording the events and progress of the mission in their tabloid book, their diaries. That one of their most important tasks. Then he kept his own notebook, or pocketbook, whose entries had helped him to win the civil action brought against him in 1897. I'll tell you a bit more about that the opportunity arises later. But quite likely, this was a repository, not just for dates and details of expenditure, but of his thoughts on other matters too, or used to practice his written English. It would have been more surprising, in fact, if on the outbreak of war, Plaatje had not resolved to put pen to paper. Now, unlike the war correspondents, all of whom kept diaries, he had no thought of writing for publication. What he embarked upon was a personal diary, something perhaps to share with Elizabeth when they were reunited, or to leave as a memento for her if he did not survive the siege. Mostly, though, he seemed to have written it for his own enjoyment, recording his private thoughts and fears, as well as describing the public spectacle unfolding around him. He chose to write it in English, but frequently used words and phrases from other languages, French, Dutch, Sesotho, Setswana, Xhosa, and Zulu. Sometimes this was just to record what other people said in their original tongue. Sometimes he used a word which he found difficult to translate, or which he thought conveyed its meaning far better than in English. For example, the Xhosa term is equal, which he used on several occasions, meaning body, but with a range of associations incorporating notions of self and personality. At other times, he preferred to use indigenous terms, because they sounded better than their English equivalents, like the Tswana term, Akasongo, derived from the sound of the Maxim gun. Essentially, though, it was in English. This seemed the natural medium for speaking in the first person, just as it was when writing to Elizabeth, and for engaging with the wider world around him. He had worked hard to improve his written English while he was in Kimberley, and it must have come on enormously in the year he'd spent working for Charles Bell. But here, in a diary, was an ideal opportunity to practice what he'd learned and to take it to a higher level, free from the strict conventions of form and function that governed his work in the office. I could continue with a bit more, but I'll move on, if I may, to a second reading. I sort of make no apologies, I think, for these being kind of slightly personal rather than being concerned with kind of broader political issues, which of course is part of them as well. But I'd like to share what I think was a rather interesting story surrounding the circumstances of Plaatje's departure from the Czech civil service. So this is in 1902, 2-3 years after the beginning of the South African War and the passage that we had before. So we're now in April 1902. The war is still going, but has not got too long to go now. According to the estate, who was a white journalist, writing some 30 years later, there was an intriguing denouement to Plaatje's civil service career. Once, when Plaatje, I quote, was third or second clerk in Mafeking, stepped because both the magistrate and the senior clerk went sick. Plaatje, I quote, calmly mounted the bench, therefore, as the regulations then directed, and weighed off one or two Saturday night drunks. Then the storm broke as news spread of what had just occurred. The Bamangwato objected, for this was a man of no standing, and the Europeans shook their heads. Plaatje was ordered to vacate the bench, and a clerk, junior to him, but of European descent, replaced him. Plaatje resigned. Of what use, Stent asked, to remain in the service in which his colour barred him from promotion? Now, Stent's rhetorical question was no doubt one that Plaatje had often asked himself. He'd been in the Czech civil service long enough to know that he was unlikely to get any further. It was galling, to say the least, to see inexperienced young white men appointed to jobs he was far better qualified to do himself. And he also felt rather strongly that the status accorded the position of court interpreter was nowhere near commensurate with the responsibilities involved, nor was the salary that came with it. He later described the £130 he was getting as a waste of time. But what to make of the story itself? There are some reasons to be skeptical. Veerstedt was well known for his inventiveness, he was not going to allow an undue concern for factual accuracy to get in the way of a good story. There were no regulations such as those he postulated, and as Mhudi Malema would point out, it was extremely improbable that Plaatje would have mounted the bench, or that the Bamangwato, who lived hundreds of miles to the north, should be in any position to object. Yet Mhudi's improbable tale, it turns out on closer examination, was by no means pure invention. From the 21st of February to the 12th of March 1902, Plaatje is known to have acted as second clerk, while the normal incumbent, Cyril Brooke, was on sick leave, dysentery aggravated by overwork, he said. And from the 13th of March to the 19th of May, he acted as third clerk, while a wholly inexperienced new appointee, C.W. Lloyd, B.A., was endeavouring to learn something of his duties. And while it's clear that the acting magistrate, Mr. Graham Green, continued to fulfil his normal duties in court, it was he who mounted the bench, the records do also reveal that for the first week of March, Plaatje acted not only as court interpreter and second clerk, but as clerk to the court, entering the records of proceedings into the criminal record book the first time he had done this. Normally, this was the responsibility of one of the European white clerks. Moreover, Stets was absolutely right about the first two cases heard on the 1st of March, which Plaatje wrote up for the criminal record book. John Martin, European and no occupation, and Hendrik Johnson, hot-dog labourer, this was the terminology at the time, were both guilty of, I quote, appearing drunk in a public place, to wit, the railway station, except that they were most likely Friday night and not Saturday night drunks. Now, Plaatje knew Mhudi well and met him on a number of occasions later in life. He must have told him about this incident. It's not difficult to see how he could have retold the story, suitably embroidered, with Plaatje in the role of the magistrate rather than the clerk to the court. Nor indeed that Plaatje's appearance in court in this capacity, never mind that he was not acting as magistrate, could well have affected local sensibilities. Stent, I think, may not have got the details quite right, and he evidently confused Bamangwato with Barolong, but it's fair to say he captured a wider truth. Plaatje, he thought, was always destined for greater things than the lower rungs of the Cape Civil Service, and was not prepared to put up indefinitely with the racial barriers he routinely encountered. Now, 3 weeks after writing up the cases of the two drunks, Plaatje handed in his resignation. In reality, though, the timing of his decision was prompted less by any fracas that may have resulted from his appearance in court, than by his plans, by now well advanced, to take up the reins of Karatia Botswana. And any frustrations that may have been were more likely generated by the inordinate amount of time it was taking for the new printing press to arrive in Mafeking, than the self-evident restrictions on his progress up the civil service hierarchy. The truth of the matter was that he was already set on a new course. So that was the end of Plaatje's civil service career. I have to say, I did get quite interested in the minutiae of what went on in that magistrate's office. I was particularly interested to find that Plaatje was actually working alongside another man called Edward Grayson, who I've got a little bit to say about in the book. He was an Oxford graduate, in fact a Balliol graduate, one of the best Oxford colleges. Quite why he then ended up in Mafeking, I'm not quite sure, but it turned out that he was actually totally useless. And there's plenty of evidence given by the magistrate about how hopeless he was. He knew no languages, even after 5 years, he knew absolutely no Dutch or Afrikaans at all. And yet, he was paid about twice as much as Plaatje was paid. So, I particularly because the Mafeking magistrate. magistrates caught the records in the archives in Cape Town are particularly full, it's possible to put together a very interesting picture, I think, of what life was like at that time. So do I have time for one more reading, do you think? Let me move on to 1920. By this time, Plaatje became in 1919 the member of a second delegation to England, protesting now not just about the Natives Land Act of 1913, but about the entire administration in South Africa. It clearly wasn't one piece of legislation, it was the nature of the regime that they were trying to change, and they were trying to appeal to the British imperial government. Well, they didn't get too far from that, too far on that. By the middle of 1920, Plaatje had accepted that, and his plans were moving on. He was busy, amongst other things, writing a novel, Mhudi, but he also wanted to travel to the United States. And this is the point, the question of Plaatje's trip to the United States that I just wanted to share a few thoughts from this passage, particularly because this does involve his relationship with his wife Elizabeth, which I, as I say, have done my best to highlight in the book. Several of Plaatje's English friends, especially Jane Cotton Unwin and Alice Werner. Alice Werner was a lecturer at the School of Oriental Studies in London. Were against his American venture. They thought he'd spent far too long away from home, but they worried about his wife and family. Alice Werner, moreover, was perturbed by his apparent enjoyment of life in England, which she thought made things worse. One of her language students, who had just seen him, told her Plaatje had said he didn't want to go home at all, but would prefer settling in England. She admitted to Harriet Clemenza that she didn't quite understand Plaatje and was not sure how seriously to take this, recognising that it might just have been a polite way of saying how much he was enjoying himself. Well, she may have been right. Nevertheless, it was the case that he had, since 1914, spent considerably more time in England than South Africa, and in many respects, he felt quite at home being there, his financial difficulties notwithstanding. The company of his English friends, freedom from the daily discrimination he faced in South Africa, the cosmopolitan atmosphere of the imperial capital, above all the opportunity to pursue his literary ambitions. Living in London certainly did have its attractions. Of course, he had his family's welfare to consider too. Some of the news at home was reassuring. His brotherhood in Kimberley may have been in difficulties, but his eldest son, Ledger, had won a bursary to enable him to go to Fort Hare, and Violet, too, would soon be at Loveday, training to be a teacher. Overshadowing everything, however, was the continual worry over Olive. She never regained her health after contracting rheumatic fever in the wake of the influenza epidemic, and as time went on, her condition deteriorated. Once, July 1920, at the beginning of the new term, St. Ledger felt obliged to delay his return to Fort Hare on her account. The very serious illness of my younger sister, he told the principal, left him no alternative, and he could not leave my mother to face this, as she is all alone at present. Now 21 years old, he clearly felt a responsibility to support his mother in the difficult domestic situation she faced. Quite what his feelings were about his absent father at that point can only be guessed at. Now, had Plaatje been asked to justify his long absences from home, he would have said that political circumstances demanded it and that he had Elizabeth's support in what he was doing. South Africa was at a critical point in its history, and the future of his people, as he saw it, hung in the balance. There was still a chance of outside intervention to help avert disaster, but this was not going to happen of its own accord. He was always adamant that Africans had to argue their own case and not to rely on white sympathizers. He had the experience and the ability to do this. Until these bigger political and constitutional questions were resolved, his personal and family life, and that of others like him, would have to take second place. Besides, how was he to earn a living to support his family, given the dire economic situation they faced in South Africa? Travelling to Europe and now to America would provide a rare opportunity, so he hoped, to earn some money for his family, as well as funds for his brotherhood organisation. Nevertheless, there were tensions between the short term and the long term, between public duty and individual fulfilment, between the wider political cause and the well-being of his family. He would not be the first of his countrymen, nor the last, to have to wrestle with these kinds of conundrums, or to worry about the effects of his long absences on his children's upbringing. So that's the 20 more passages I could read, but I think I'll read it other than simply to say, to express some part of our thanks. First of all, I'd like to thank Chicano, the publishers of this book. If you have a chance to look at it, I think you'll agree they've done a tremendous job in its production. The photographs look absolutely wonderful. And even Chicano was saying that this was the best book that they thought they'd published. And when the publisher says that, I think it maybe means something. So if you have a chance to look at it, see what you think. But I'm very grateful to them for the job that they've done. My thanks, of course, to SPU, Sol Plaatje University, Professor Mhudi, Sabata, for hosting this event and for all the support and encouragement that they have provided. And all those who've helped with the research, because this has gone on for a long time, this project. But I've been particularly fortunate in that the wonderful staff of the Africana Library here in Kimberley and the McGregor Museum have been wonderful supports throughout. So I'm very grateful indeed for what you've done and your contribution to this project. And of course to the descendants of the Plaatje family, who again have been wonderfully supported, the Sol Plaatje Trust for keeping that flame going. Johan Kronje, Daniel Plaatje, thank you very much for giving your support over the years since you were about that high. And finally, thank you very much to all of you who've come to this. I hope it's been of interest and that the book may appeal to you. So thank you very much.